Okay, great. So now let's talk about the final one, optical sensors. This usually means that we're trying to measure some electromagnetic radiation directly. So this is kind of a topic where you're seeing a lot more adoption of these types of sensors, not just in the medical sphere, but in the physics areas and all sorts of things when you're trying to get information where maybe you can't touch what it is that you're looking at, but you can observe it or have cameras. One area is radiation thermometry. Basic theory here is you know the relationship between a surface temperature of an object and how much radiant power that's coming off of it. So you can actually, in this case, this is a temperature application where we're measuring temperature that's radiating off of a surface. Now, why can we do this? Well, if we think about light again, refresh our minds on physics, visible light is everything between the red and the violet. So basically roughly 700 nanometers to 400 nanometers in wavelength. That's the range about what we can see. But if we go to wavelengths a little bit longer than 700 nanometers, we start getting into the infrared range. And if we can have a system or a sensor that detects in that range, we can start measuring heat and measuring that. So it's IR that we're actually measuring in this case. Case in point, measuring temperature in someone's ear. So these are what doctors use all the time. They have a little, they measure the heat coming off the tympanic membrane. What's nice about it, because they get to stick it in the ear and they can measure it off the membrane, they're getting rid of all the external noise of temperature. So it's fairly accurate in that sense. Now, again, they have contact ones, but this one is a low contact way to do that. And so they have an IR sensor with a shutter so that they have a window. A sensor that picks up infrared light. They have to amplify that. They also have an ambient sensor, which does not hit any of the IR. So it's out of that pathway so that they can compare the two and see what that looks like. So they know what the ambient temperature is versus this sensor, so they can get a much better differential measurement of the temperature itself. And then they time this so they can take multiple measurements and get kind of an average, which gives you another added benefit of reducing noise. And oftentimes they'll go straight to a microprocessor and digitally display it. Again, we could do the same thing and we could send it somewhere else. So that's an essential one of these. Another way that we do this is we can have a separation where we have an excitation light, an LED in this case, and we have a photoresistor or a sensor. Before we were just looking at an IR sensor, but now we're having a sensor with an applied energy across either a baffle or whatever it is we want. So this is something we use when we're like trying to take, say, the oxygenation in our finger. You put those little things on your finger. Well, one of the things lights up your finger. And really what we look at is how much light actually gets through to the other side in the infrared sensor. So really we have your finger is the baffle between these two things. And if you time these things right, or light it up in a certain way, you actually can measure all sorts of interesting things. Because if the resistance changes, or if the opacity changes, or the volume changes between the LED and the photoresistor, you can measure that. And that's actually what happens with photoplethysmography. Your finger, as you have blood pulsing in and out of your finger, you have slight variations in your venous pulse and in the arteries, and so you get slight variations in volume. So as the volume goes up, you have more of the light getting absorbed. As the volume goes down, less light gets absorbed. And so you can see these pulse waves, and once you have the information, you can actually calculate the pulses. And that's how we get pulses per minute. We can also determine, with some more fancy calculations, the type of oxygen, how much oxygen you have. So an oximeter also makes use of this application. And now they're trying to get into other things too, to measure your CO2, to measure other things in your blood using more variations of this non-invasively. So you don't need to have a needle to go in to find out what's the oxygen in your blood, what's the CO2 in your blood. And so it's going to be interesting to see how many more types of these things that they can develop. Last but not least, let's say the amount of light that we're trying to measure is really, really, really small. So small, in fact, that we need to measure down to a single photon, one unit of light. So kind of the best players in that area. Now there's quantum sensors that are coming out, but traditionally has been photomultiplier tubes. And so if you can see the picture down at the bottom, there's all these tubes that they have with a scintillation crystal that they're mounted to. And they basically are put on there with kind of like a little adhesive gel that allows for good conductance between those two for the light to pass through. And so the scintillation crystal, what it does is it takes one photon that is higher energy, and the scintillator basically, it hits an electron and uses the photoelectric effect and makes more electrons that are lower energy that are in the domain of what the photomultiplier tube can detect. Then they have a focusing electrode so that it starts hitting all these dinodes. Now what happens is when it hits a dinode, now these are each energized to different voltage levels. And so when it converts a photon to an electron at the photocathode, so this electron gets focused, hits a dinode, and once it hits a dinode, it releases typically at least two electrons, or then four electrons, or then eight, or then eight electrons, and so on. So every electron, as it keeps bouncing, keeps getting amplified by the number of electrons as it keeps bouncing down these dinodes until it gets to the final anode on the back end. And so it's got an amplified current because you have all these electrons that gets converted back into a voltage that you can measure at the electrical connectors on the back end. So this has been used a lot in a whole bunch of different areas. So for example, the picture shown here, this is called a PET scan or a PET CT. And this is where they combine instruments like this, but they have them arranged instead of a flat, they have them arranged around in a circle. So they have an array that goes all the way around in a donut. And we can actually measure the light that's coming off from annihilation events. They actually use matter-antimatter events that occur where we're trying to figure out what's going on, and we can detect things like cancer, where that is. And they superimpose it over a CT scan, and then not only do you see the structure, but you see where the cancer is in place of that structure. Fluoroscopy is another area, and there's lots of other. In physics, there's a lot of other areas where they use photomultiplier tubes. So that's it for all of our sensors. That's a lot, I know. We went through lots of different types. And again, we're just scratching the surface. There's even more types than what we talked about. But at least now you have a sense of all the different types of areas. And just about for almost every measure end that you want to measure, there's a sensor for that, if not 10 types of sensors for that. Maybe there's something more esoteric, like if you're trying to measure gravitational waves, and maybe not. But for the most part, for most things in the human domain, there are a lot of different types of sensors that are out there for all different types of applications. So explore that, and I'll see you next time. Take care.